And you are listening to 94.1 KPFA in Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. Up next, we are continuing with our KPFA Summer Fun Drive. Up next, Making Contact.
And that's right. It is 1 o'clock at this time on a Friday. You will hear the theme music of Making Contact, and that is coming in just about 60 or 90 seconds or so. My name is Andrew Stelzer. I'm here with Salima Hamarani. I am one of the producers of Making Contact. She is a production intern over there, downtown Oakland, close cousins of KPFA. And we're just going to delay the start of the program for a very short period of time to let you know that we need your support. KPFA needs your support. Independent radio productions like Making Contact need your support. This is the pledge drive. This is the time when you ante up to support the community radio station you love. The phone number is 510-848-5732. We're about to bring you a great show by independent producer Reese Ehrlich, who you've heard on these airwaves before, reporting from the streets of Libya on what's been happening in the aftermath of the revolution, on aspects of American intervention, the also important oil question. We're going to play that in just a minute, but I want to tell you some special gifts we have for you if you call and pledge. We have Walking with the Comrades, newest book by Arundhati Roy, for a $75 pledge. That's a thank you gift. We also have a CD of her speech, which we're going to bring you a short portion of towards the latter end of the hour for $50, both of those for a $110 pledge. So the phone number again is 510-848-5732 or 800-439-5732. You can donate online at kpfa.org. Salim, a couple words before we go into the show?
Yeah, I mean, listening to the Libya show, if you are interested in donating to media that is a little bit more critical of intervention, of U.S. intervention, then this is the time to be donating. This is a great show. Both of our gifts are wonderful. Jungles of Resistance is just an awesome show. Arundhati Roy is a great speaker. The number is 510-848-5732, 1-800-439-5732.
Okay, let's get on with the show and call and make your pledge. This week on Making Contact.
They're worried about a new strongman emerging.
Like a new strongman emerging using his own militia to impose his will upon the Libyan people.
Libyans overthrew hated dictator Muammar Gaddafi last October, but the country remains chaotic. Armed militias once allied with the U.S. and NATO now attack government offices and engage in extortion rackets. Elections recently took place, but the new government will have a hard time controlling the militias. While the West proclaimed a great victory for so-called humanitarian military intervention, the Libyan aftermath is far more sobering. On this edition, independent producer Reese Ehrlich brings us a special report from Libya. I'm Andrew Stelzer, and this is Making Contact, a program connecting people, vital ideas, and important information.
In military fatigues and carrying AK-47 assault rifles, the Zintan militia surrounded the building and entered without a fight. They weren't seizing a Gaddafi stronghold. They were taking an oil company CEO hostage. The militiamen demanded extortion money. It was the second time the company had been attacked in a month, prompting one official to tell me, "There's a new Libyan mafia." And Libyans are fed up. Recently, tens of thousands of Libyans gathered around the country to demand dissolution of the militias. Over 60 armed groups compete for power with a weak national government. Here in Benghazi's main square, spokesperson Nadia Nur Mohammed tells me the central authorities have got to take charge.
We want to have government control over the police and army and have them as the official armed forces. We want the government to collect the weapons and eliminate the militias. We want security for the country, and we don't want anyone in power associated with the Gaddafi regime.
Another protester, Abdul Wahab, concedes that the militias won't give up their weapons easily. I ask him, what can the government realistically do?
There is no end-of-term solution just like that. They have to tackle it gradually, and you cannot collect the weapons by force, because that will initiate another conflict that we can't do without. There are some other methods. Instead of giving money to the freedom fighters for nothing, they should give it to them in return of their weapons. The heavier the equipment, the higher the pay. So
a weapons buyback program.
Yeah, a weapons buyback program. The money is squandered anyway, so we should put it to good use.
Others at the demonstration complain about the estimated 25% unemployment in Libya. Strikes and street occupations flare up regularly throughout the country. Protest leader Mohammed Riyad says the government should be helping to solve the unemployment crisis.
We want the government to provide jobs and at a minimum provide unemployment insurance and training programs. We're asking that the government establish a database that includes all the unemployed workers. Then it should start job training programs that can help small and medium-sized businesses.
But other Libyans say economic and political problems are understandable given the short time since the uprising. Ibrahim El Mayat, leader of the NGO Libya Progress Association, comes from a prominent family and recently returned to the country from his home in Britain.
Well, yeah, things are chaotic here in Libya, but, you know, what else can we expect 6 months after liberation? I mean, we spent most of 2011 fighting Gaddafi, and we just liberated the country last October. We have a long way to go in a country which lacks proper state institutions, doesn't have a system of government. We have no heritage of political parties or political engagement. Of course, things are not going to be simple. There's going to be a lot of problems along the way, and we're going to face some issues. It's not all going to be plain sailing, but I think we're on the right track.
So the Libyan glass is either half full or half empty, depending on who's drinking the water. But without question, Libya remains a fractured country. It wasn't supposed to be this way. In February 2011, Libyans rose up in a spontaneous rebellion. At first, most Libyans opposed foreign intervention, but the exiled leadership, strongly influenced by the U.S. and European powers, quickly began calling for an outside military attack. The National Transitional Council, the U.S.-backed exile body, exaggerated the dangers of massacres, at one time claiming Gaddafi would kill half the population of Benghazi. Gaddafi's troops did kill civilians when they retook cities during the subsequent civil war, but such huge massacres never occurred. And many dozens of civilians died in NATO attacks. Many Libyans, particularly those living in the eastern city of Benghazi, are convinced that the rebels would have prevailed even without NATO intervention. Interviewed during an outdoor rally, Master Sergeant Hamid Hijazi, a spokesman for Air Force officers in Benghazi, says the rebels didn't rely on NATO for victory.
Even before the French Mirage jets attacked, we destroyed a lot of Gaddafi's planes. We forced his troops back 100 miles from Benghazi. Even if NATO didn't come, we would have destroyed Gaddafi's army. Every day we were repairing more planes and sending them into battle. We had disabled planes, and we made them fly.
If, for some reason, Gaddafi had succeeded in attacking Benghazi, entering Benghazi, what would have happened?
We would have fought door-to-door to the last man.
But other Libyans are equally convinced that without Western intervention, they would still be fighting a civil war, similar to what's happening in Syria. Abdul Aziz holds that view. He was a construction worker in London before returning to Tripoli a few years before the uprising. I hired him as a translator and only later learned his fascinating story. Traffic was at a standstill and people jostled one another as we walked through crowded downtown Tripoli. Aziz picked up a Cockney accent during his London exile years. He stands about 5 feet 5 inches tall, with gray hair, and is in his late 50s. But he's one tough fighter. He tells me that back in late 2010, he knew a showdown with Gaddafi was looming. Aziz bought an assault rifle on the black market.
Before that in February, you know, Gaddafi, he's armed.
his the Libyan on his side, and it's the only way I can get a weapon. I just like to buy it from one of Gaddafi's boys. I kept it for about 2 months under the ground, wrapped in a plastic bag. And then on the 20th Ramadan, we just decided to, when we knew Tripoli is going to be liberated today, because we were like under siege for 6 months. And then we decided that the 20th Ramadan to come out and do something.
You bought a Kalashnikov from one of Gaddafi's supporters.
Supporters, exactly.
And how much did you pay for it?
1,500 dinar.
That's a lot of money.
It's worth it.
All right. So tell me, what was it like when you stormed into his Gaddafi's compound?
It's a happiness. It's a happiness to get rid of one dictator who's been there for 42 years. Nobody can do anything about it. It's a big fight. It was a big fight. A lot of dead people from his part and our part.
And then, so the next day, I know you went back, and everybody was looking for guns, and you were looking for paperwork.
I'm looking for paperwork, exactly.
Why?
Because I think I found it more interesting. I want to know what Gaddafi doing in that compound.
And what did you find?
I found a list for Gaddafi's bodyguard, the family bodyguard, and the bodyguard of Muhammad al-Gaddafi, his son.
With a list like that, you could tell who were the top military people involved with Gaddafi.
Exactly, yes.
Azouz kept the original list, photocopied it, and turned the information over to the government for future prosecutions. But the judicial system barely functions. As a result, many of the militias take revenge into their own hands. Azouz describes how, months after Gaddafi's defeat, he found a former Gaddafi army officer hiding in a Tripoli neighborhood.
He was just like a growing beard, and he was shopping in the supermarket. He was shopping. And I spotted him, and I phoned the boys, and I said, look, there's a guy who was here. So they come and take him straight away.
And so what happened to him?
I think he's still in jail.
But as far as you know, he hasn't had a trial yet?
No, not yet.
Azouz's militia is holding the former officer in a makeshift jail outside Tripoli. Militias are imprisoning many hundreds of others around the country. Azouz argues that the militias are only holding them temporarily.
People doing it now because it's they want to like help, just to help. I don't think they mean to do any damage to anybody.
But such imprisonment without trial has come under strong criticism from human rights groups. It's not clear how many months or even years such prisoners will wait before a trial. Since the end of the Civil War last October, the U.S. has sought alliances with Libya's army officers and militia leaders. The militias are aligned with political parties. Such alliances could quickly develop into a system of warlords, with politicians illegally siphoning off government funds to pay for the salaries and arms of their militias. I spoke with El Habib Alamin, a famous poet, political activist, and official with the Ministry of Culture. He says Libyans are quite familiar with the United States' post-war political manipulations in Iraq and Afghanistan.
Those wars in Afghanistan and Iraq didn't result in improvements for the people of those countries. I think some leaders here in Libya are trying to get Western backing to become the next Hamid Karzai. I don't want Libya to become an ATM for Western oil companies while they abandon the people of the country.
The National Transitional Council downplays such concerns. NTC officials argue that local and national elections show they are serious about building democracy. But Minister of Economy Ahmed Al-Khoshli admits the transitional government has limited powers.
Ours is a transitional government. The next government will decide all important issues. We are setting the laws and stabilizing things for the next government to take action.
I ask Al-Khoshli if the transitional government can stop the armed militias, which have become a power unto themselves. In May, angry militiamen fought a two-hour gun battle outside the prime minister's office, demanding bonus payments for the time they spent fighting Gaddafi. Al-Khoshli sounded almost apologetic about the attack.
They had legitimate demands, but it was not the right way to do it. Libya is seeking to be a country of laws with transparency. People who made the revolution didn't do it to earn a bonus. Most refused the bonus. they return to their jobs. For the rest of them, there is a mechanism to study who deserves to get the payment.
You're listening to Making Contact. That was the show called The Battle for Libya's Future. And before we turn to the show, we want to talk to you a little bit about why you should donate to us. My name is Salima. I am a production intern at Making Contact, which, as Andrew mentioned, is in downtown Oakland.
Yeah, Oaktown.
The nice thing about interning at Making Contact is that you learn how to make shows that are really subtle and that are not one-sided. And as part of our gift package for you, if you donate today, we're also going to be sending out a CD by Arundhati Roy, one of her speeches called Jungles of Resistance. That's if you donate $50. If you donate $75, we include the book Walking with the Comrades by Arundhati Roy, and you can get both for $110. And listening to this show on Libya, what really sticks out is that there's a lot of things in the show that you don't hear on mainstream media. And you'll also notice this when we're talking about Arundhati Roy. She actually... this book is based on her experience living with the Maoists, which are an indigenous group in India who have been attacked by the government. And it actually has a lot in common with the show in Libya, because a lot of the battles are actually over mineral resources, oil, bauxite, actually, specifically in India, and this very small community's response to try and protect their homeland and stop themselves from being kicked out and sent to the big cities.
Yeah, the phone number to call and get either of those gifts, either Arundhati Roy's CD or the book or both, phone number is 510-848-5732 or 800-439-5732. You can also pledge online at kpfa.org to keep great radio like this on the air. As Salima was saying, this is an example. Hopefully all your friends listen to KPFA, but maybe not all of them do. And so when you talk to folks who aren't plugged into important information resource like this, I think very often they see things good and evil, black and white. Those people out there, whether it's the people in the jungle in the case of India, or those rebels out there, the ones with weapons, the bad guys. It's way more complicated than that. And what we do here on KPFA and on Making Contact is we try to explore those complexities. What motivates someone? What are the issues behind a rebellion or a resistance or people just trying to hold on to their own land, natural resources, self-determination? And getting into those issues and getting a bigger understanding is what you've come to rely on KPFA for. And so we need you to support this radio station so we can keep bringing that information to you. Again, the phone number is 510-848-5732. I'll say it slower. 510-848-5732. We need to get some phone lines lit up before we go back to more of this investigative reporting from Libya.
The number again is 510-848-5732 or 1-800-439-5732. That's 1-800-HEY-KPFA. And Andrew was just talking about how, you know, sometimes it's really difficult to know what's really going on. You take the case of Libya, we talked a lot about intervention on the mainstream media, but it was really difficult to know what was actually going on. This idea of somebody being good and somebody being bad, where the actual situation is very complex. The nice thing about places like KPFA and Making Contact is that we really do send out reporters into these areas, and we start talking to people, and we really try to figure out what's going on. And we try to, like, unhook all of these groups and try to figure out what the tensions are. In Libya, a lot of that has to do with oil. The nice thing about the Arundhati Roy piece, too, is that, you know, a lot of these Maoists were just labeled terrorists. And that was how we read about them, that there were these terrorist groups in the jungles that were just killing a lot of people. But it turns out that the situation is a lot more complex and a lot more subtle. They're not just terrorists, even though the Indian government labeled them as such.
Sound familiar?
Sounds very familiar. So the real story is much more complicated, much more subtle. And there are listeners out there who want that kind of subtlety, that want that complexity. They're not looking for simple stories.
Oh, and it looks like we got one. Oh, at least we had one phone line lit up. Folks, I'm staring at a box across the room from me, and it has 16 or maybe even 20. My eyes aren't so great. But all these phone lines are dark, and we need to get two or three of them lit up before we can go back and listen to more of this report from Libya. KPFA is a precious community resource, and whether it's, as Salima was saying, free speech radio news with reporters on the ground in Libya, whether it's interviews from the region on shows like Flashpoint or Hard Knock Radio, or any voices from the Middle East and North Africa, I mean, there's so many different angles and approaches to these important stories that you hear on KPFA that you're not going to hear anywhere else. And if KPFA is not here, I dare to speculate where you would get this information and where you would hear these voices. You know, the internet is one thing, but where are you going to hear the voices of the people? Rhys Ehrlich, in this program we've been listening to, is talking to everyone from people working at the water treatment plants to shopkeepers on the street to protesters in the street, exploring this new age of post-Qaddafi Libya. And KPFA was with you and bringing you these voices throughout pre and then the fall of Qaddafi, and now where are things going now when it's not on the front pages on the newspapers around the country? You know, what's going on with the elections? You've been tuning in and hearing reports from Free Speech Radio News and other programs here. So to support that programming, we need to get three people to call right now. That's you. You've got your cell phone or maybe even your landline, doing it old school. Pick up the phone, dial 510-848-5732 or 1-800-439-5732. That's 1-800-HEY-KPFA. Again, for a $75 pledge, you can get Arundhati Roy's new book, Walking with the Comrades, which chronicles her time living with the Maoists in the jungle and talking to them and finding out what these so-called rebels were really about, what they were trying to protect. For $50, you can get a CD of Arundhati Roy speaking. For a $110 pledge, we'll give you a gift of both of those. But we need you to call right now, whether it's $20, $50, $100. Hey, how about a grand? Whatever it is you have to spare. We got one phone line lit up. Let's just get two more right now, folks. 510-848-5732 or 1-800-HEY-KPFA.
You know, we have a whole lot of volunteers sitting around waiting for you to call. And if you don't, they're just going to eat all of this free food, which is not how they want to spend their hours.
And that reminds me, since we're talking about that, we want to thank today's food donors. Be Healthy Honey, Donna's Tamales, Natural Grocery Company, and Flacco's. So thank you. There's a tremendous community support coming from the donors. There's community support with the volunteers who are waiting, 10, 12 feet away from me through a studio wall, sitting kind of salivating by the phone, waiting for that phone to ring. And so we need you to satisfy that. Oh, looks like we got one more. We got to get at least one more phone line lit up, folks. Number is 510-848-5732 or 1-800-439-5732. We want to go back to this documentary by Rhys Ehrlich, independent producer, who's brought us over the years reports from Palestine, from Bolivia, from Syria, from Egypt, from all over the world, the important hotspots. I don't even know how he gets into some of these places and gets access for some of these interviews, but we're bringing these voices to you. And if you want us to be able to keep doing that, please call 510-848-5732, whether it's $20 pledge, $50 pledge, $100 pledge, whatever it is. We have thank you gifts. Oh, it looked like another line was kind of halfway lit up. Salima, how are we doing?
I think we might have gotten three. Might be it.
Oh, okay. I think we've gotten.
We've got two.
We've got at least two and a half. So we're going to go back to the program right now. Again, making contact with Rhys Ehrlich. The phone number is one more time, 510-848-5732, or donate online at kpfa.org. Support your community radio station. We now return to a report from Libya, produced by freelance journalist Rhys Ehrlich.
There is some good news in Libya, if you're an oil company. One day I drive 45 miles west of Tripoli to the Zawiya oil refinery, the second largest in Libya.
Shukran khuna. Shukran Allah barak fikum.
Security is tight as we check in at a guard station. To my left stretches the tranquil Mediterranean Sea. On the right is a maze of buildings, pipelines, and storage tanks. Muammar Gaddafi helped inaugurate the refinery back in the early 1970s, and his smiling visage was only recently removed from the walls. I met Khalifa Saleh, the operations manager, who has worked here for 34 years. Saleh stops in front of an enormous grid of pipes and tanks. He boasts that the facility has very modern equipment. The refinery even produces most of its own drinking water.
This is to produce water for drinking and for processing, and mainly for drinking.
Oh, I see. So it's a desalinization unit to turn seawater into drinking water.
That's right. Like to have a tour at the township and our hotel at the township. Let's take a coffee there.
Sure.
Yes, relative. It's for us.
The Zawiya storage tanks took a few stray bullets, but the refinery came through the civil war largely unscathed. Salih says he had to persuade both Gaddafi's soldiers and the rebels that they had an interest in preserving the facility.
We have to convince both parties that the refinery, it's for us, for the future generation. I'd like to maintain it safe. It's not the right time to fight around it. Even myself, I talked to them. I said, this is not the proper place to make a conflict, because if there's something goes wrong in Zawiya here, the Zawiya township and even Sabrata may be affected, because we have our refinery, we have our Akakos tanks, we have Brega tanks, we have lubricant storing. So it looks like a big bomb, you know.
Yeah, it would be a huge fire if
that's
they were
right.
Bombed.
That's why I'd explain it to both sides.
So the Zawiya refinery and much of the country's other petroleum infrastructure remained intact. I asked Salih if the refinery's production of gasoline and other fuels has reached pre-war levels.
The production today at 15 minutes after 11, the capacity is 102% capacities for both process units.
So it's over 100%.
Yes, please.
While Zawiya escaped serious problems during the revolution, it faces the same kind of internal turmoil as many other Libyan institutions. In May, refinery security guards complained bitterly of not being paid by the government for 3 months. A group of guards trapped the head of the refinery in his office and beat him up. A shot was fired. Salih says that the guards' anger was misdirected. He says the army, not refinery management or the National Oil Company, was now responsible for paying the guards' salaries.
If somebody is not paid for 3 months, you have to critically do something for it. Yeah. And yesterday they reached an agreement like this. But anyway, we don't expect that whatever happened yesterday, that some people, they come and force and, you know, come with argument with the chairman of the company, it's wrong. You don't use force. You didn't take rights by guns. You only say, state what you need, and we'll take care of it.
Despite such turmoil, Libya's overall oil production is now approaching pre-Civil War levels. British Petroleum announced it will resume exploration again. France, Italy, Spain, Great Britain, and the U.S. are getting their crude. The National Oil Company says it earns $4 billion a month from selling oil. But Libyans wonder where all that money is going. Ibrahim Ali, chair of an NGO called the Libyan Transparency Association, says the corruption from the old regime is being carried over into the new. He explains that in the old days, European oil companies sold the oil at world market prices, but purchased it significantly below market rates. He says the difference was pocketed by foreign corporations and Gaddafi cronies.
The real price outside is $10, and we find inside the contract, for example, $4 or $3. There's a corruption inside this contract. This difference, they will get it by commission outside, and you don't know. Till now, it's like that, you know, and nobody knows about these things, you know.
Al Mayat of the Libya Progress Association, who we met earlier, confirms the problem of ongoing corruption.
The entire system was riddled with corruption. Gaddafi systematically destroyed institutions of state and created this environment which was really prone to corruption, fraud, and theft. And we need to set up a new system, and that's going to take a long time. And until we really get a grip and stop the rot, we're not going to see corruption ending in Libya.
One way to limit corruption, according to NGO activists, is to make the oil contracts public. Mayet says that way the public can compare the terms to see if some companies are getting sweetheart deals.
There needs to be a serious review of old contracts, and we need to put in place a good strategy for future contracts. I don't think anyone can expect to come to Libya and get really favorable terms. The Libyans want to have good terms and do business on their own terms and to develop our country. We don't want to be seen as exploitable.
But foreign oil investors disagree. Ibrahim Lias is an official with Medco Energy Oil and Gas. He welcomes me into a modern office off of one of Tripoli's major streets. Lias says companies don't want their contracts with the National Oil Company, or NOC, made public because it could affect profits.
If we're talking about the contracts between the oil companies and the NOC, that's very, very confidential. There is no third party can read it. And it's confidential because each contract is unique by itself. You don't want even other companies to know about it. Some things they you don't want the public to see it. And those contracts, you are talking about the companies and their assets and their shares and their shareholders. So any news coming about these may affect the shareholders.
In fact, European and American oil company executives complain that they should be getting better terms on their Libyan contracts. After all, they argue, while Russia and China opposed military intervention, the U.S. and NATO countries helped liberate Libya from Gaddafi. I ask Lias what he thinks of that view.
Oh, I agree with that. If we let the things happen the way Russia and China wanted it at one time, we will not be free now. It's those who you know, stood beside you, you're not going to forget that. There is no way. Plus, this is normal.
But the Libyan public doesn't want to reward foreign governments who, until very recently, had cozy relations with Gaddafi. Al-Amin says, given the history of widespread corruption, oil companies should make their contracts public.
The Libyan people need transparency about the relationship between foreign countries and our government and about the economic contracts. Someday it will come out. If it's secret, the Libyan people will be very angry at the government.
While Libyans wrestle with how to regulate the oil industry, other economic sectors are showing signs of recovery. But it's slow going. On a busy street in central Tripoli, I visited a hole-in-the-wall grocery store. Store owner Ahmed Ali puts money in a cash drawer. He tells me business was disastrous for most of last year. There was a shortage of cash, and banks severely restricted how much money could be withdrawn. Inflation was rampant.
During the fighting, there's practically no business at all. We opened only a few hours a day. There were a lot of shortages, so prices skyrocketed. It's 100% better now because people have money to spend.
While business is better than during the war, the grocer still barely scrapes by. NGO leader El Mayet says that's typical. The civil war increased the disparity between rich and poor. Oil industry executives drive BMWs, while many ordinary Libyans have a hard time buying food.
It's a terrible paradox that Libya is an extremely wealthy country, and yet there's a lot of poverty here, and our national infrastructure is in an appalling state. We have broken roads, poor sewage, terrible schools, poor hospitals. It's really not fair. We ought to be living very well. It's a population of only 6 million people. In the future, Libya's oil revenues should be spent for the benefit of all the people in Libya.
But that's not the view of the U.S. and the International Monetary Fund. The IMF issued a report recently offering many of its traditional neoliberal prescriptions for Libya. The interim government is following the IMF lead by studying how to privatize state-owned companies, encourage investment on terms favorable to foreign corporations, and eliminate government subsidies for basic food items to poor people. The Ministry of Economy is considering eliminating the subsidies. Economy Minister Al-Khoshli acknowledges that complying with Western prescriptions won't be easy.
We have a technical committee to study future policies and changing the subsidies. The study is not complete yet. It's very difficult to suddenly cut the subsidies. It's been part of our culture for 42 years. People will complain.
And that's not all Libyans are complaining about these days. Late at night, men in suits and traditional dress mingle in the Tavisti Hotel Cafe here in Benghazi. The hotel is a monument to Gaddafi-era architecture, with a cavernous lobby and scratchy, overstuffed upholstery. The hotel cafe serves as an informal meeting place for government officials, political activists, and reporters. And no issue is more discussed than federalism. A significant movement based here in eastern Libya now advocates autonomy from the central government in Tripoli. Under Gaddafi, many everyday tasks, such as obtaining a business license, required a trip to the capital. So far, such policies have not changed. Guma Asiati, leader of a pro-federalist political group, calls for a system that would leave purely national tasks in the hands of the central government while devolving power to the regions.
The federal government will be the Minister of Foreign Affairs, Justice, Central Bank, the Army. What's belong to each side of Libya should be ruled by the people of the side itself. So each side of Libya will have their own security and safety and also development. That's what we're looking for.
It's an attractive proposition here, where most of the country's oil is pumped. Earlier this year, a gathering of tribal and militia leaders even declared the region autonomous. But it hasn't had much practical effect because of continuing turmoil throughout the country. The demand for federalism is controversial even here. Virtually everyone agrees that local governments should have more power, but that doesn't mean breaking the country up into federated regions. Fatia Steta is a retired English professor in Benghazi.
I was one of the people who demonstrated against it, and there were a huge number, right, in the court square against federalism. The eastern parts need to have their own administration. We don't need to go all the way to Tripoli for any paperwork or no. And this can easily be done. Local government.
The real debate isn't about government democracy. It's about money. Federalists want the East to take 35% of the state-owned oil company profits, a far larger percentage than its share of the population. Opponents say that will effectively divide the nation. Steta says budgets should be based on need.
Libya is a unified country, unified land. It isn't just the eastern parts that are neglected, and the revenues should be divided equally among all these areas, and all the projects should be given to all these areas.
The federal government should allocate money for roads, for example, anywhere in the country that needs roads.
Anywhere.
Many Libyans hope that the national elections that were held July 7th will help resolve the country's problems. A pro-U.S. alliance headed by former Prime Minister Mahmoud Jibril won the most votes, followed by two Islamist parties. But the elections were marred by serious violence, and it's not clear if the new government will overcome the power of the militias. Back at the Benghazi demonstration, protesters split into small groups and debated the prospects for democracy. Protester Abdul Wahab says elections will probably not resolve the ongoing issues of corruption and armed militias.
So this chaos and this disorganization will have to carry on for some years before we establish a firm nation. Nation with laws, a constitution that everybody adheres to. But I'm relying on the factor of time.
Most seriously, Wahab says, Libyans worry that continuing political chaos could produce a new dictator.
They're worried about a new strongman emerging.
A new strongman emerging using his own militia to impose his will upon the Libyan people.
For Making Contact, I'm Reese Ehrlich, Benghazi, Libya.
And you are listening to KPFA, your favorite radio station. My name is Andrew Stelzer. I'm here with Salima Hamarani. We are both representing Making Contact. We're also representing KPFA. And you are representing the person that we're trying to reach. That's right. You look in the mirror or put your hand in front of your face. We're talking to you. We are trying to raise money to keep KPFA on the air right now, to keep great programs like Making Contact, which you just heard, an on-the-ground report from Libya on the air. We can only do that with your financial support. This is how community radio works. And so I'm going to give you the phone number to call, whether you can make a $20, $50, $100 pledge, $200 pledge, whatever it is, we need your support. The number is 510-848-5732 or 1-800-439-5732. You can also pledge online at kpfa.org. We have a $1,200 goal. We're more than halfway through the hour, and I don't exactly know how we're doing. We had a few calls earlier, but we need to get at least three or four phone lines lit up. You just heard a report from independent journalist Reese Ehrlich on the ground in Libya. And, I mean, whatever I say isn't as important as what you just heard, but the voices, the perspectives, the information about the role, not only the role of the U.S., the role of natural resources in terms of oil, the role of money in what makes the world go round, and is what determining it is what is determining the political future of Libya and a lot of the so-called Arab Spring countries. Oil in particular is very important, and towards the end of that program you heard about the debate over federalism and whether local provinces of Libya should be able to maintain control and garner the benefits of their own natural resources, whether it should be national. Suffice it to say, the oil companies, the U.S. government, are involved in overt and clandestine ways in those conversations. And we're going to be following those conversations and those negotiations here on KPFA as we have over the years for decades. But we can only do that with your support. The phone number is 510-848-5732. If you appreciate perspectives on international news, if you appreciate perspectives on ways in which capitalism and these large corporations influence our communities and our lives, we need you to express your support right now. Salima, what were you thinking listening to that show?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's really important to investigate the ways in which corporations internationally, how resources internationally are causing conflict. It's too simplistic to just say people are rising up against a dictatorship. It's much more complex than that. And community radio and media that is not supported by corporations themselves are the folks that are going to go and find out what's really going on, right? So we don't get funding from corporations. We get funding from you. We get funding from our listeners. So we have a little bit more of an edge when it comes to figuring out what's really going on. And really, the Arab Spring is what started our uprising here in the U.S. It started Occupy. Those are our brothers and sisters. But mainstream media has kind of stopped covering it. Africa is on fire right now, all of it, the entire continent. You're not hearing about it. We heard about Egypt. We heard about Libya. We heard about Syria. And then it just kind of disappeared. We heard nothing about the rest of Africa, right? Unless you were listening
to
KPFA.
Is there a rest of Africa?
There's just Northern Africa.
Oh,
that's
okay.
It. But the rest of Africa is in revolt. This is ongoing. Things are still going on in Libya. Things are still going on in Egypt, the military, the elections. We're not really hearing much about it anymore unless you're listening to community-sponsored radio, because we want to know what's going to happen in these countries, what's going to happen to these dictatorships, what's going to happen to the corporations that have money invested there.
Yeah, and so again, the phone number is 510-848-5732. Speaking of natural resources and corporations, we have two special gifts for you. Arundhati Roy, the famed Indian author, wrote a book called Walking with the Comrades about her time in the jungles of India with the Maoist rebels who are defending their lands against mineral grabs, natural resource grabs, supported by the Indian government and companies who want to get those minerals out of the ground that these people have lived on for centuries, if not millennia. For $75, you can get Arundhati Roy's book as a special thank you gift if you make a $75 pledge. For $50, you can get a CD of Arundhati Roy speaking and reading from her book, and hopefully if we get a couple phone lines lit up, we're going to hear a short clip of that speech in just a couple minutes. For a $110 pledge, we'll give you both the CD and the book, Walking with the Comrades by Arundhati Roy. Again, this is Arundhati Roy, tremendous author, her newest book, Walking with the Comrades, about her time in the jungle. She spent several weeks there at the invitation of the Maoists, the Naxalites, as they're also sometimes called. for a $75 pledge, you get that free thank you gift. It looks like we have one phone line lit up. We need to get at least three phone lines lit up before we can go to listen to Arundhati Roy. 510-848-5732 or 1-800-439-5732. What's happening in Africa? What's happening in India? What's happening in Europe? Making Contact last week brought you a show about the Olympics and the displacement taking place and gentrification related to the Olympics, which the rest of the world is celebrating. Rah, rah, rah. Well, we all know what happened in Atlanta. It's about to happen in Rio. It happened in Vancouver. We also brought you again last week about Denver, Colorado, which many don't know is the only city to ever reject the Olympics after it was awarded. So, you know, the untold stories of history, you know, as they always say, the winners get to tell the story of history. That's not the case at KPFA. We also tell the stories of those who didn't so-called win, those who are still battling to protect their livelihoods and their cultures. If you appreciate that, and if you're interested in Arundhati Roy's new book, Walking with the Comrades, please call and make a pledge. Whether it's a $25, $50, $100 pledge, $200 pledge, we need to get a few more phone lines lit up. The phone number is 510-848-5732. Again, 510-848-5732. Or you can donate online at kpfa.org. We want to play some Arundhati Roy. And I guess, Salima, you've been reading this book.
This is a great book. And, you know, I really like what you said. Once again, before I start talking, the phone numbers are 510-848-5732. 1-800-439-5732 or online at kpfa.org. The book is really interesting, and I really loved what you said about not letting the winners tell the story. A lot of what Arundhati Roy says about the Maoists and the jungles is that they're fighting a losing battle. They really are. There's not many of them left. This is their last-ditch effort to reclaim their land, and a lot of them know that they're going to die. But because they're going to lose, it doesn't mean that we can't bear witness to that struggle and we can't pass it down and we can't tell that story. Those are the most important stories of people that have struggled and maybe lost. And that's what I really loved about the book. You know, and she's not sympathetic. She's not merely sympathetic to the Maoists. She does have a critique. She worries about the number of innocent people that are killed. It's actually a very interesting read, and it's really a story about this community's almost suicide pact to defend themselves. It's really, really fascinating. And if you donate $50, you get that book. If you donate $50, you get the CD, Jungles of Resistance. If you donate $75, you get the book, Walking with the Comrades.
Yeah, and I know there are people out there who actually were at the bookstore or online thinking about getting this book. So now you can support KPFA and at the same time get this book. Then you can read the book, you can talk about what you read, and you can pass it on to a friend. You can pass it on to several friends, hopefully, if they give it back to you, although it's so good they might not want to. But to educate yourself, to educate your friends and neighbors, KPFA is an important resource for you to fill your mind, and then what is in your mind spills out into your community, and that's how we educate each other. We need to get a couple phone lines lit up. We have a few people to thank. Let me just give you the phone number one more time. We want to get to hear some of this speech. 510-848-5732 or 1-800-439-5732. I want to thank Rashi from Palo Alto. Thank you so much.
And I want to thank Maureen, and this person's from Oakland, and also Jeffrey from Berkeley, who gave us a huge donation of $300.
Sweet. So, folks, whether it's $40, $80, or $300, we need you to call right now, 510-848-5732. I feel like I'm taking a chance saying let's listen to a few minutes of this speech because we don't have the phone lines lit up. But if we listen, will you call? I'm talking to you. You, the one who's actually, yes, you, the one who's thinking about calling and making a donation. Oh, look, we had like a false start. One of those lines almost lit up. 510-848-5732 or online at kpfa.org. Okay, let's just listen to a few minutes of this speech. You'll call while we're listening. You can get the Arundhati Roy book for $75. We'll be right back to tell you how we're doing.
Sometime in September, I think it was, or maybe a little earlier, the Indian government announced its latest war against its own people. It was called Operation Green Hunt. Actually, unlike America, which has been waging war against other countries almost every year for the last so many decades, the Indian government has been waging war against what it considers its own people ever since it became a sovereign, independent country. So the Indian Army has been deployed in Manipur, in Nagaland, in Mizoram, in Kashmir, in Punjab, in Bengal, in Telangana, in Goa. It's been continuously at war. And now there are plans to deploy it in central India against the population of indigenous people who live in the forested heartland of India. If you look at a map of India and you map where the minerals are, where the forests are, where the indigenous people are, they're all stacked up on top of each other. And in these forests you have $3 trillion worth of bauxite, you have iron ore, you have copper, gold, diamonds. It's the old story, you know, the indigenous people must be moved out because India has to develop, it has to become a superpower and so on. So around 2005, the Indian government signed a series of memorandums of understanding with many mining corporations, infrastructure companies, road building, dams, all of that. It was sort of transformed this whole swathe of territory into something else. And at that time, the Indian Prime Minister, Manmohan Singh, the head of the world's biggest democracy, who's never won an election in his life, announced that the Maoists were the single largest internal security threat. When he said that, the stocks of the mining companies just ratcheted up because it signaled that the Indian government was now going to move and really clear these forests and fight this battle. At the time, the media, which is, of course, as you all know, even here, this is the case, that the entire economic turnover of the media comes from corporate advertising. So many of the media companies are owned by mining companies, either directly or, you know, through advertising, controlled by them. So this entire spectrum of resistance, not all of it Maoist, the Maoists are just the most militant end, but outside the forest there are Gandhians, there are, you know, all kinds of movements, the whole bandwidth, they were being called terrorists. Basically, poverty and terrorism were conflated, and it was a crime to be poor. It is a crime to be poor now in India. And we were all being called upon to condemn these terrorists and to support this war that had been brazenly announced, Operation Green Hunt, where 200,000 paramilitary forces were moving in, encircling these forests. Already a tribal militia called the Salwa Judum had been formed in Chhattisgarh. It had moved through the villages. It had burnt down something like 600 villages. 350,000 people were on the run, 50,000 had been moved into police camps, the rest were simply missing. Some had joined the Maoists, others had migrated to nearby states, you know, trying to eke out a living in some way. Basically, the land was being cleared. But to their credit, activists from all over India gathered and began to raise their voice against Operation Green Hunt. And it was around then that I got a note under my door, and that led to my spending some weeks in the forest walking with the comrades. And I'm going to just read you little excerpts from this essay and then we can talk about it. The terse typewritten note slipped under my door in a sealed envelope confirmed my appointment with India's single biggest internal security challenge. I'd been waiting for months to hear from them. I had to be at the Ma Danteshwari Mandir, that's a temple, in Dantewara, Chhattisgarh, at any of four given times on two given days. That was to take care of bad weather, punctures, blockades, transport strikes, and sheer bad luck. The note said, writer should have camera, tikka is like a bindi, and coconut.
All right, I know we're just getting to the heart of the matter. Arundhati Roy is about to go into the jungles, invited by the Maoists, But, you know, we're tantalizing you here. You can hear the rest of that if you pledge to KPFA, the CD, Jungles of Resistance, Iron Dottie Roy speaking about and reading from her newest book for a $50 pledge. For a $75 pledge, you can get that book, The Physical Thing. Walking with the Comrades is the name of it, Iron Dottie's newest book about her time spent with the rebels in India, rebels, so to speak, Maoists, so to speak, basically tribes and communities of people who are being forcibly removed from their land because of the natural resources that that land sits on. This is a story that we hear about in many different forms all around the world here on KPFA. Natural resource grabs, people who are being take their right to self-determination being taken away because of financial reasons. And if you appreciate knowing what's going on in India and in Libya, as we heard earlier this hour, and all around the world, please call and support KPFA. This is the time when we have to pay our bills. 510-848-5732 or an 800 number, 800-439-5732. You can also pledge online at kpfa.org. I'm Andrew Stelzer. I'm here with Salima Hamarani. We are making contact and KPFA family here, and it's 1:56. We have 4 minutes left to make our $1,200 goal, and I think we're only about a third of a way there. I'm not totally sure, but we need to get some phone lines lit up right now. So if you've been thinking about it, now is the time. Now is the end of our hour. 510-848-5732. Whatever type of pledge you can make, whatever type of donation to KPFA to become a member you can make, even if it's just $20, if it's $75, you can get Iron Dottie Roy's book, $100, $150, whatever it is, please call right now.
And you know, you just heard about Libya. We just gave you a show about the Maoists in India. Andrew talked about some of our past shows on the Olympics and gentrification. We've had shows on realignment, giving birth in prison. We have some great shows coming up. Andrew can talk to you a little bit about what we have planned, but we really need the money to be able to produce these shows and for KPFA to be able to air these shows. We really need you to donate. If we could just have a couple of buttons light up. Right now we have nothing. If we could get like two or three lit up, just two or three before the end of the hour, that'd be great. If we can get all 20 of them lit up right at the end, that'd be wonderful.
Let's do it. We got volunteers standing by. They're waiting to get your call right now. As Salima said, we bring you great programs every week. I just finished a program up that's going to be airing soon on the power of police and prison guard unions. We have program in the works we're planning about the fire industrial complex, about issues of, you know, are we planning our communities correctly? Why do these wildfires happen every year? And, you know, should we be allowing fires to burn? There's environmental issues. There's social issues at play. And, of course, economic issues at play. If you appreciate the perspectives you hear on KPFA, this radio station, the electricity, the equipment, everything down to, you know, the photocopiers, the phones that we're using to take your pledges all cost money. We can't do this without you. And so we need you to pledge and support this community radio station. I thought we had one phone line lit up. We got to get a few lit up. It's almost, we only have 2 minutes to go. The phone number is 510-848-5732. You can pledge online at kpfa.org. Again, that phone number, pick up your phone right now, 510-848-5732. Support KPFA, support Making Contact, support community radio. As Salima said, you can see many of our great shows at radioproject.org. That's our website. At kpfa.org is where you can pledge. $75 pledge will get you a free gift of Iron Dottie Roy's Walking with the Comrades. For $50, you can get a CD of the speech you were just starting to hear. The phone number again, 510-848-5732.
You know, we also have shows coming up on drones, domestic uses, surveillance. We have shows coming up on private education and charter schools, which are huge things happening across the nation that nobody's really talking about. But we need your support to be able to make those shows. The phone number is, again, 510-848-5732 or 1-800-439-5732. And when you get home, if you're in the car listening, you can go online and donate at kpfa.org.
Yeah, a lot of you are listening online. You're at work. You know, if you're at work, you can sneak away from your boss, or if you do it online so they can't even tell and make it look like you're working, whether it's drones where there's issues of surveillance by law enforcement, whether it's education where privatization is an issue, our society is being transformed, and it's being transformed at an even faster rate in the past to keep up to date with what's going on, to be able to advocate to change society in the way that we want, in the way that you want. You need information, and this has been one of your primary sources and your most important sources of information, KPFA. Please support this. Keep us on the air. Keep that information flowing. We got 30 seconds left. We have two phone lines lit up. We need to get two more. 510-848-5732. Again, 510-848-5732. You can pledge online at kpfa.org. Again, a $75 gift gets you Arundhati Roy's new book. Please call now.
And you are listening to 94.1.